You'll find this an interesting topic. We as an IAP North Delhi trying to find out some interesting topic, although there are floods of webinar, and still I think it is a knowledge dissipation, and you can join us there. Thank you.
Now over to Dr. Rajni.
Thank you, Dr. Shalini and Dr. Dinesh. Is my screen visible?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I'll thank IAP North Delhi to give me this opportunity to interact, so that we'll be discussing about a topic which is very common in our office practice. So a fainting child is, I think no pediatrician has not seen a fainting child. Everybody has come to this scenario one or the other day, and it's a very common problem. So let's see, how can I demystify a fainting child, and we will see as a case-based scenario. So identifying the problem and lighting the right bulb is a main clue. At times, it is so challenging that we are not able to actually pinpoint the diagnosis. So we have to be very vigilant. We have to see each clues that what will give us a diagnosis. Especially when investigations give us no clue, then history and examination is the main part, is the main focus for a clinical case. As we all know as a clinician, that the history and examination holds the main part of the diagnosis. So what I'll be discussing is, it will be case-based scenarios for the differentials. I'll be discussing clues for each differential, and the approach will be basically on history and examination, the investigation plan, what is good, what is not, what is the limitation of the investigations, and the management. Briefly, one or two slides I'll discuss about the mild blunt head trauma in children, how to go with it, when to investigate and when not to investigate. So let's start. Fainting child, as we have already known, that it is a very common in office practice, and syncope is the most common etiology out of that. Misdiagnosis is very, very common. It is known in pediatrics, up to 40% of the cases get misdiagnosed. We are not able to pinpoint it is because of the cardiac cause or some other cause. So if we see this diagram, we know that vasovagal attack is the most common etiology, which forms about 60 to 80%. So major chunk of a fainting in a child is a vasovagal syncope, which is a benign nature. So first thing we should keep in mind is that mostly it is benign, but yes, we have to investigate to rule out the life-threatening etiologies. Next, cardiac disorders, which we all look after, which we all run after to find out that what is the etiology, is basically to rule out the life-threatening conditions. We are all afraid of the sudden deaths, and that is why we rule out the cardiac disorders. And yes, the other part of the chunk is mainly neurological, seizure, the psychological causes, of course, is also a major part, ruling out the other metabolic and other conditions, which we'll discuss in further slides. So thorough evaluation is warranted, especially in the first episode. Maybe we'll not give any management clues, or just reassurance is the treatment, but evaluation should be thorough, at least in first go. And a very important part in fainting child is you should take care of any injury. Suppose these episodes are recurrent and you know that there are chances of injury, then you will counsel the child that way. History and examination gives a maximum meaning, because here investigations fall short to give you the diagnosis. So we should always focus on the very small nitty-gritties of history to tease out the differentials. Let's start with a case. She's an 11-year-old girl. She had a fainting episode in the school while she was studying in a maths class. The girl is able to recall that she felt dizzy and she was weak. When she stood up, she suddenly stood up to give an example, to give an answer in a class, and she felt dizzy and weak, and she suddenly collapsed. The teacher reported that the child has pallor during that time, and she had loss of consciousness, which was very brief, up to 15 seconds, and she quickly regained the consciousness. There was no after event for that child, no abnormal movement, no trauma, no prior history of similar episode, and no family history. The examination at the ER showed that the pulse was normal, blood pressure was normal, blood sugar was normal. So basic evaluation was all normal, including ECG. So what is the impression? This is a prototype case which we all come across. So mostly this is syncope. We'll see that what are the pointers which favors this. So it is a most common paroxysmal disorder in children and adolescents. Most cases are benign, and evaluation is required to rule out the life-threatening causes. Sudden cardiac death which we all fear is actually very less. It is 4 in 1 lakh. Though this is not Indian data, but then also it is a very less population which will who will have a sudden cardiac death. And there are specific pointers when we should evaluate for a specific life-threatening etiology. 15 to 25% of the children will, in first 2 decades, they will have an experience of fainting. So we can see that how common it is. And female obviously will have a preponderance in this age group. 15 to 19 years is the peak age. The recurrence rate is also very high. So out of 100, at least 1/3 will have, in first 5 years, there will be a recurrence rate. By definition, it is transient, complete, and there is a loss of consciousness. So each word is important, that loss of consciousness is there, it is transient, there is loss of muscle tone, and it leads to, it is due to the global cerebral hypoperfusion. So it is rapid in onset, it is short duration, the recovery is quick, spontaneous, and complete. It excludes any falls, it excludes any psychogenic causes, it excludes epileptic causes, it excludes coma. So basically it has to exclude all other causes, finding no etiologies. Mostly is a vasovagal syncope, which is the main part of this definition, that it is rapid, it is short duration, and the recovery is quick. These are the terms and conditions which actually come with the syncope. This word is pre-syncope, first thing. That is near syncope. That is the feeling that the one is about to pass. The one will suddenly have a feeling that they have a loss of consciousness, and they might have a transient loss of postural tone, but there will be no loss of consciousness. It is the initial stage of syncope, which is known as pre-syncope, having that feeling of passing away. Orthostatic tachycardia has a specific definition in children age group, in child age group, that is 12 to 19 years, it is more than 40 beats per minute when a child is lying supine and he is made to make stand, which is non-exertional, like he is standing and not walking. For 10 minutes, if we keep on monitoring and there is a sustained increase in heart rate, more than 40 beats per minute, that is orthostatic tachycardia. Orthostatic hypotension is drop in systolic blood pressure more than equal to 20, diastolic blood pressure more than equal to 10. So these are the specific definitions which we all should remember, because that forms an important part of examination. Reflex, that is neurally mediated syncope, is a most common, and the main pathophysiology behind is there is a bradycardia, that is fall in heart rate and vasodilation, which leads to global cerebral hypoperfusion and leading to syncope. So this is the mechanism of syncope. Cardiac syncope, reflex syncope, and orthostatic hypotension are the three common pathophysiologies which run through this diagram. Reflex syncope is due to emotional stress. It slows the heart rate. There is vasodilation, and further it will lead to decrease in the cardiac output. It will lead to low systemic vascular resistance and low blood pressure. So it is said that the mean blood pressure falls to 30 to 40, falls below 30 to 40 of that level. And finally, it will lead to global cerebral hyperperfusion and thus loss of consciousness and loss of postural control. The triggers are very important for syncope. We should know that positional change, like sudden standing up, sudden stooping down. These are the changes which might trigger the mechanism of syncope, and they can have this phenomena. Intercurrent illness, any emotional stress, any painful stimulus, hot or crowded environment, during meal and during exercise. So during exercise, we should remember, is one of the very specific feature which we should ask, because this can give us a clue for any life-threatening condition. Pre-monitoring symptom, nausea, blurred vision, any hearing or vision impairment, any lightheadedness, sweating, cold and clammy skin, any weakness or tremulousness, which are noted. So triggers and pre-monitoring symptoms forms a basic part of the history which we should ask in these children. Now, what are the red flags? If it occurs during exertion, like if the child is playing or doing something and suddenly there is a fainting, so that makes a call that you have to investigate the child extensively. When the child is supine, that means cardiac syncope is a rare event when the child is supine. Sudden positional change leads to this. That is the vasovagal syncope. So when it is supine, you should think that this might be some seizures or some other epileptic activity. So you should go for investigation. when the child is asleep, that is other criteria that you should investigate. Exertional chest pain is another thing, which is prior to syncope. It leads to the etiology that the child might have any cardiac etiology in a swimming pool. Secondary to any auditory stimuli like a loud noise without warning. If there is no prodrome and suddenly the child just faints, then you should obviously think of a red flag symptom. This is a red flag symptom and you should investigate. Structural heart disease and family history is very important in these children. In neurally mediated syncope, that is a reflex syncope, nausea, vomiting, these are the features which we always try to elicit, and these we mostly get also. That emotionally stressful event or standing in a crowded hot environment, it can happen during the meal, it can happen after the exercise, not during the exercise. So during the exercise, you will think of other etiologies which can lead to sudden cardiac death, any cardiac structural problems with head rotation. Suddenly, if there is a twist in the neck, you can have a reflex syncope. So this is a case two. He is a 15-year-old boy. He had two episodes of loss of consciousness. First was 6 months back when he was in the market. It was a hot and crowded place. He felt giddy. There was a loss of consciousness and he regained consciousness within a very short span of time by his own. So this looks like a simple syncope. First episode, nothing was done during that time. Second event happened after 6 months. This time the child was watching TV. He suddenly stopped responding and he had a vacant stare, which was followed by loss of consciousness. There was no motor, ocular, any color change or any temperature change which was there. This time he regained the consciousness after 10 minutes. And after that, the child complained of drowsiness and severe headache. There was no family history and the child was otherwise doing good in school and no other background developmental history to suggest any etiology. So what is the impression in this case? Two episodes. First was a simple syncope kind of episode. Second episode looks to be a little tricky. We have to analyze each and every symptom in the second episode. So let's go forward. How to differentiate a case of a syncope versus epilepsy? This this flowchart is very important, and this we should try to remember each and every point in this table. First thing is position. Like, what was the child during that time? Was he in a sitting position, in a supine position, and was there any sudden position change? So in recumbent position, syncope is uncommon. Epilepsy is more common. And any premonitory symptoms, which I had discussed in the table, is it there or it is not there? If the child is able to recollect that he was having the feeling of dizziness, any epigastric pain, nausea, vomiting, blurring, any muffled voices which he was able to get, then these are the premonitory symptoms. You can get it in syncope. In epilepsy, yes, aura might be present. The aura can have a typical features, like he can have an epigastric pain or there can be sudden abnormal noise also he can feel in the ears. Color or temperature change. The pallor and cold skin, this usually the bystander or the observer will tell you that the child had sudden pallor or cold skin, then it is more in the favorable of syncope. The onset is gradual. When it happens sudden, it happens more commonly in epilepsy. If it come to the number, it can happen many times in a day in epilepsy. Syncope is usually one or two episodes in a day, so it is not very common, gradual onset, and the frequency is also less. The duration is less, as we have already known that it is a quick response. It will happen suddenly, and regain of consciousness will also happen suddenly. The eye deviation, the muscle movement is common in epilepsy. I'll discuss again the muscle movement in syncope, the pleomorphic movements which I have written. I'll discuss in the next slide. Incontinence is common in epilepsy. Injuries are rare in syncope. So if an event happens suddenly, there is a loss of postural reflexes, loss of protective reflexes, there are chances of injury that will happen more commonly in epilepsy. Post-ictal event is very important. You know that quick regain in consciousness goes in the favor of syncope. And if the gain in the consciousness is slow, and there is a episode of headache or confusion or drowsiness after that event, that goes more in the favor of epilepsy. So can syncope have seizure-like movements? Like any child having any movement after that event will go to epilepsy, or can it still be syncope? That is our question. So convulsive syncope is a word that whenever there is a global cerebral hypoperfusion, it can lead to cortical suppression and disinhibition of limbic and subcortical structures, which will lead to abnormal movements. So yes, abnormal movements or seizure-like movements are possible in syncope. They can have stiffening, They can have myoclonic jerks. They can have limited chronic movement, like one or two times they can have just a hand jerk or a body jerk. So these, the clue here is the movements will occur during the event phase, during that loss of consciousness phase. It will not happen the before or at the onset of the event. So when you have this history, you have to ask that when does this happen? When did this happen? There will be first global cerebral hyperperfusion and then these movements will happen. Other than that, when it is a seizure, it is epilepsy, these movements will happen prior and then there will be loss of consciousness. So the timing is important here. So in this case too, our case too, because the second episode, he had a very late regaining consciousness and also he had headache and other symptoms after the post event. This goes in the favor of epileptic event and we should evaluate the child that way. And in this case, EEG was done, sleep deprived, generalized pipe wave discharges could be seen, and he was labeled as generalized epilepsy and was managed accordingly. This is a 13-year-old girl. She had sudden loss of consciousness again while watching TV. There was no prior history of any symptom. Just prior to that, she had a shrill cry prior to loss of consciousness. She was found hyperventilating during that time and she was difficult to regain consciousness. She had to be taken to ER. She was still not responsive. When we received this child in ER, the vitals were stable. What trick we did that the resident, he tried to touch the eyelids. Like if we examine the child in vitals, the eyelids, there will be a blink reflex. So that gives us a information that this is a malingering and this is not a true loss of consciousness. And the child also had some bizarre movements, which again led us to think that this could be a psychogenic event. So there were still a pointers that prolonged loss of consciousness with the preserved vitals and no other features, with a suspicious history in the background, we have psychogenic thing in our mind. So this is a clue: prolonged loss of consciousness, difficult to regain back. With a non-epileptic etiology. It favors towards a non-epileptic etiology. So when to suspect a psychological cause? When there is acute onset. Sometimes we get that the child has started to have loss of consciousness, multiple episodes in a day, like 4, 5, 6, and she is not responding to any therapy. Ultimately, the child has to be admitted. And then you suspect that there might be some circumstantial evidence for the psychological thing. The history has to be probed into. Episodes without injury. We have already discussed when it is epileptic, injuries are known to happen. Whenever there's a loss of postural control, injuries might happen. Young female, bizarre symptomatology, forceful hyperventilation is another clue. When there is a loss of consciousness and the child is hyperventilating and you find nothing in the vitals, nothing in investigation, you again think of any non-epileptic event. Production of various type of noises, partial consciousness, forceful eye closure during the event and prolonged recovery time is a common scenario which we come across. So misdiagnosis in epilepsy. In this child, when we received the child, the first instance epilepsy was made as a diagnosis. We did the investigation. EEG was normal with suggestion. Should we finally meet the diagnosis of paroxysmal non-epileptic event? But yes, even with the best of the hands, sometimes it is difficult to have a diagnosis of epilepsy or non-epileptic event. This was a paper in 2016 in which a large number of children were seen. 40%, about 40% children were not found to have epilepsy. In 30% of the children, they were referred without any doubt that they did not have epilepsy. The diagnosis was disproved. So out of the confirmed cases of epilepsy, 30%, the diagnosis was disproved after further evaluation. So this is a major percentage that 30 to 40% of the cases are actually getting misdiagnosed. So 9-year-old girl, this is the next case we come across. She had 4 episodes of vertigo, visual blurring and nausea. In 2 such episodes, she had loss of consciousness and headache was reported for prolonged duration in 2 episodes. In the past history, she had recurrent episodes of headache over past 6 months. In family history also, there was a history of migraine which was present. So we have a child who had vertigo, visual blurring, nausea, which seems similar to the syncope, the premonitory symptoms. Even the loss of consciousness is there and headache is also there, which we should take as a specific pointer and try to probe the history a little further. So is it a syncope or is it as a seizure or it is a non-epileptic event or is it something else? So when we probed the history further, we came to the point that this could be a migraine with brainstem aura. Brainstem aura is arising from the spasm of the vertebral basilar system, leading to the cerebellar ischemia. So what will happen with that ischemia? This is an aura which happens prior to the episode of headache. So headache will start after this aura. This can start anytime between 5 minutes to 60 minutes of headache. It can have dysarthria, it can have vertigo, it can have hyperacusis, tinnitus, diplopia, and ataxia, and which is not attributable with sensory deficit and decreased level of consciousness. This is again a pointer. That is how it comes in the differential for syncope, because decreased level of consciousness is also there. But yes, loss of consciousness complete, which is there in the definition of syncope, usually is not there. So we have to find out the specific clues in history that whether the child had clear loss of consciousness or it was just dizziness and the child did not feel well. And the headache history is important. Case 5 is a 14-year-old boy. Again, a very interesting case. He had two episodes of loss of consciousness. First was 6 months back. He was playing cricket outside the house and suddenly he had stiffening of the body during the event and there was loss of consciousness. So this was thought as a syncope and he was evaluated, in which first evaluation he did not get anything and he was not on any treatment. Now the second episode happened where the child was at home and he was having his dinner. There was no premonitory symptoms again in this time and he again had loss of consciousness. And again, this time there was stiffening. So because two events has happened and possibly because of the stiffening episode, the possibility of epilepsy was kept in this child. We had to rule out the cardiac event again because the child had first event during the exertion, during exercise while he was playing. So both the events were kept as a mind that we want to reevaluate the child, cardiac event and the seizures. So when this child came to me, he was referred with the MRI and EEG, obviously. MRI was normal, EEG did not show any specific changes. ECG, which was reported normal, I could see that there was QTC prolonged and we got a cardiac evaluation done in which 2D echo was normal. Pediatric cardiologist confirmed that QTC was prolonged. Now, what is the case? Is it long QT syndrome? Should we work up further on that line, a pure cardiac evaluation, or should we go further? Here, further history was proved that there was a history of fatigue and tetany in hand during the exams. This was very interesting. Whenever he used to go for exams, his hand used to become like this. It was perfect tetany. And there was history of tingling, which was happening frequently over last 6 months to 1 year. Especially during exams, when he wanted to write very fast, this used to happen. So this history gave us a clue that this is something else and we should rule out a metabolic cause. On examination, Tinel sign was there and OSIC sign was also positive. So we confirmed that this could be a case of hypocalcemia and which could explain all the findings. Final diagnosis was severe hypocalcemia. His calcium was 6.5 and he had very low PTH. So hypoparathyroidic hypocalcemia was there and this child was further worked up by pediatric endocrinologist. And after starting supplementation, he had no further episodes. He comes in follow-up for last 1.5 years. No further episode has happened. So simple, common, treatable metabolic causes should not be missed. Here the learning point is we should always keep the simple causes in our mind and we should not just go by the ECG that it is QTC prolonging and we have to look that way. The other secondary etiologies causing this ECG abnormality should be worked up. So this is a whole list of differentials. Cardiac. In cardiac, there are two major things. One is structural, that can be ruled out by 2D echo, and the rhythm abnormality that can be done by ECG. And if there is a problem in the ECG, in the first basic 12-lead ECG, then we can go further for the Holter monitoring. That is with the opinion of the pediatric cardiologist. In neurology causes, seizures, any kind of seizures like generalized, focal, myoclonic, atonic, all the variety of seizures can lead to a fainting attack. It can mimic like a fainting attack. Any vascular events like a posterior circulation stroke, they usually come with vertigo, headache, and loss of consciousness. That is a very common manifestation of a stroke, a transient ischemic attack. Acute hydrocephalus. This is a rare one, that if a tumor is there in the third ventricle and it causes acute hydrocephalus, when we stoop down, there can be a loss of consciousness. Basilar migraine, I've discussed a prototype case. Disorders of the vestibular system can be there. Narcolepsy, that is a sleep disorder. The child will suddenly have a sleep. When the child is waking up, he suddenly goes into sleep, which is felt as a loss of consciousness, that the child has lost his consciousness. But child is actually in deep sleep in narcolepsy. neural mediated syncope is very common. That is the most common. Vasovagal syncope, reflex, orthostatic and situational. After a prolonged coughing, like a corticosteroid cough, the child can have apnea and loss of consciousness, especially in a young child, young infant. Sneezing, micturition, stretching, these all are situational, which can lead to syncope. So having that history of situation during that time is very, very important. Psychological, PNS, Munchausen syndrome, somatization disorder, all varieties of psychological etiologies can lead to fainting. Other metabolic is very important. That is hypoglycemia, electrolytes, I've discussed the calcium thing, and the endocrinal disorder, which can lead to fainting. Drugs and toxins should always be kept in mind, especially in adolescents, because there can be a history of abuse, which we are actually missing. And this is not uncommon in metros that the child might have some kind of abuse thing going on. So how do we approach a fainting child? Pre-event, event, and post-event. These are the specific questions which we should ask. What was the child during that time? The trigger points, the position. Was he eating? Was he lying down? And what was he doing? What was he feeling during that time? The pre-monitoring symptoms. And the bystander or the witnesser, whoever has witnessed the event will tell how is the child behaving and what were the signs and symptoms during that time. Clear description of the event, that it was only dizziness or loss of consciousness, and what was the exact duration. Any ideation or gradual, was it a gradual or was it sudden? Any stiffening, jerking of the body, any urinary incontinence, color change, cold and clammy skin. This all autonomic phenomena, that is color change, cold and clammy skin, favors more of syncope. How to differentiate between convulsive syncope versus seizures? We had seen that convulsive syncope is after a deep cerebral hyperperfusion, the child might have some movement, which can be stiffening or some one or two jerks. Not a typical seizure-like phenomena. If a clinician feels that by history you get a typical seizure-like phenomena, you should think as an epilepsy and you should further work up that way. What is there post-event? So pre-event, event, and post-event, all these three detailed history has to be taken during that time period. Video recording, if you get it, then it's a good thing and it helps a lot in making a diagnosis. And bystander closure is important. If the event is witnessed and whoever has witnessed the event gives you the history, that will be a better thing to make you closure to the differential. Family history is important in any case of fainting, any history of sudden death, any history of arrhythmia, cardiac disease, epilepsy, migraine, or any drugs at the home which can cause, which the child might have taken accidentally, especially the toddlers, and they can have fainting. Any past history of similar event, any pre-syncope, like this kind of events have happened, there is no loss of consciousness, but they have felt the pre-monitory symptoms, that is pre-syncope. Any headache, vertigo kind of thing in the past, tingling in the hands or legs, that is for hypocalcemia. Any abnormal movement like myoclonic jerks or history of drug intake or chronic illness in the child. Personal and social history, of course, when you have ruled out the organic thing and you have specific pointers for the psychological thing, you should go for this history. In adolescents, especially, they might have anxiety, they might have depression. Physical examination, needless to say that detailed examination should be done. In heart rate, all the pulses should be well examined. In blood pressure, supine and standing. Heart rate and BP both has to be seen. When the child is made supine and he is at rest, making him stand for 10 minutes and then getting again heart rate and BP examination. Pallor, any cyanosis, clubbing is for hint for any cardiac structural heart disease. Features of hypocalcemia like tinel sign or fix sign, eliciting a blink reflex when you suspect paroxysmal non-epileptic disorder, any marfanoid habitus, when you think that the child might have a mitral valve abnormality and child might have sudden death. Eye dislocation is just a pointer for the marfanoid features like homocystinuria. They can have this kind of features. Any joint laxity. These all are the rare things. But we should look forward if the child is very tall, you should think of a marfanoid features. Any dysmorphism, any neurocutaneous marker, especially for a neurocutaneous syndrome, which can lead to epilepsy. So to make a differential that way, systemic examination, cardiac and neurologic is very important, and psychological assessment, of course, if the child is adolescent and you find no other etiologies, no other clues to have any specific organ affected. So investigation is tailored according to clinical suspicion. The basic investigation like CBC and iron profile and calcium profile. If you have specific clues, like the child has pallor, you'll go for the iron profile. In a small child who has breath holding spells, you will go for iron profile, CBC. If the child has tingling sensations, has history of tetany, you'll go for the calcium profile, especially in adolescents. the electrolytes, specific clues if it is there. ECG is mandatory in all cases of hinting chain because that's a class one evidence for syncope. American Heart Association in 2017, that ECG has to be done, mandatory 12-lead ECG has to be done. Cardiac ECG 2D co Holter and cardiac catheterization, that is according to a cardiologist. Neurological examination, EEG, we do specifically a sleep deprived EEG to have to increase the yield of the EEG to know that what is going on, and to it increases the yield of the EEG to have a generalized epilepsy disorder. MRI brain, if you have any focal feature or you have a high suspicion of having a neurological feature and epilepsy, then you should go for MRI brain. Psychological evaluation and evaluation of stressors in a case scenario, in a typical case scenario. We should always remember that investigation may not lead to diagnosis in 40% of the cases. So investigations may be futile, but history and examination will give you a provisional diagnosis, and you should stick to it after ruling out the other etiologies. Role of tilt table test. This is very commonly we have heard and we have seen the adults doing it. In pediatric, this is not validated, and not CT profile is also not validated. So the main utility is that it can differentiate the reflex syncope or orthostatic hypotension or a seizure disorder or psychiatric disorder. So it looks to be a very helpful test, that do this test and get the investigation and then you're done with the diagnosis. But it is mostly done in the adults, and for that it is protocolized. For pediatric, the protocol is not very clear, the safety is not very clear, and it is not validated. There is very high rate of false positivity in these cases. So that is why we do this test only in a specialized setting, and when there is a recurrent episode which is happening and you have a high suspicion that this is a reflex syncope only, and you have to rule out other causes. What do we do in this test is the person is made to lie on a bed and his head is made upright 60 to 80 degree, and for 15 to 60 minutes the child is made to stand, made to lie in that position with a footboard and with a vital monitoring. If suppose there is a bradycardia and hypotension which occurs during that timing, 15 to 60 minutes, then you can make a diagnosis of vagal syncope. So let's see the yield of investigations. Ambulatory ECG monitoring has very low yield, up to 14%. Even a clear cardiac event might not lead to ECG abnormalities. Like we say in epilepsy, a clear epileptic event might not lead to any abnormality in EEG. EEG might be absolutely normal. 2D echo, only yield is less than 50%, especially when you think of a cardiac diseases. When you have those red flags and you think that there is a cardiac disorder, 2D echo might lead only to less than 50%. Yield of history examination with ECG, up to 50%. EEG in epilepsy, the sensitivity is low. So that means up to 60% maximum EEG, that is the surface EEG, routine EEG will give you abnormality. In a clear epileptic event also, EEG might be normal. That we commonly come across in clinical case scenario. Specificity of course is high. So 80 to 100% of course, the specificity is there. In normal children also, EEG might be abnormal. So in a case scenario, when you think of epilepsy and EEG is normal, it does not rule out epileptic disorder. Having an EEG abnormality in which there is no clinical symptomatology is also common. So we should keep that also in mind. Management is tailored to the etiology. Emergency care management, like management of the injuries, if it has happened, that should be taken care of. I'll discuss in the subsequent slides. Neural mediated syncope, that is the vasovagal syncope. What do we do in these cases? We do parent education that this is a benign disorder. There can be recurrence and you have to avoid triggers. The adolescents are smart enough. When you discuss with them that these are the premonitory symptoms and you should try to recognize the premonitory symptoms and avoid the triggers like sudden position change. And what are the specific triggers for that case? You should tell them that you should try to avoid it. Lifestyle changes, diet, taking a fixed proper diet, and fluids important. Salt intake should be a basic, that we should tell them that this is the basic salt requirement and you should not try to avoid the salt. We have to tell them the maneuvers, that whenever you feel the premonitory symptoms, you should do these maneuvers like leg crossing or buttock tensing or squatting. Because they should sit down for squatting and they should increase the venous rhythm so that a proper syncope does not happen. In extreme cases, some elastic compression bandage can be advised so that they increase the venous rhythm. Drugs, beta blockers or alpha adrenergic agonists, midodrine. A low-dose midodrine is the first drug of choice in a general pediatric age group for vasovagal syncope if it is happening very recurrent. Fluorocortisone is often commonly used. Now, this was the traumatic brain injury, which I was speaking about. This is a CT algorithm. American Academy of Pediatrics in 2019 has laid down the criteria that when should you investigate a child who has come with a history of mild traumatic brain injury. If the child has fainting and he has got an injury and he has got a hematoma at some part of the brain, whether to go for CT, whether to admit, whether not to admit, these dilemmas they have dealt with. Mild, moderate, severe was a previous classification which would deal on the GCS score and the severity of the child. But one word they have coined as clinically important TBI is traumatic brain injury. These are the injuries who require intervention, like neurosurgical intervention or hospitalization, and for this traumatic brain injury. So that is called clinically important traumatic brain injury. If the GCS score is 14, less than 13 goes to moderate. So a mild comes between 13 to 15 GCS score, altered mental status, and a palpable skull fracture, you will obviously go for CT. This A is for less than 2 years, B is for more than 2 years. So any child, when the GCS, altered mental status, or the palpable skull fracture, you will obviously go for CT scan. When there is a non-frontal scalp hematoma and there is a loss of consciousness, there is severe mechanism of injury. They have defined four criteria, like if there is a motor vehicle accident in which the passenger has gone out, there is a high volume thrust, there is no helmet worn by the motor biker, or there is a fall which the patient goes 3 feet away, like that comes in the severe mechanism of injury. If the mechanism of injury is severe and you have these features, then the clinician experience and the multiple findings which they have written, if the age is very small, the physician experiences that this might be a serious thing. There are the multiple findings and there is clinical worsening. Then you will go for CT scan. Suppose it is not there and you have just a small hematoma over the occiput, but there is no severe mechanism of injury, then the risk of TBI clinically significant is less than 0.02%. So in that case, CT scan is not recommended and you can avoid having a CT scan. You can obviously keep the child in monitoring, but CT scan can be avoided. When the child is more than 2 years, and you have these features again, that the history of loss of consciousness, history of vomiting, severe mechanism of injury, severe headache is there. Again, physician experience, multiple findings, worsening of symptoms, and parental preference. Obviously, you'll get a CT scan then. When these features are not there, then CT scan is not recommended. So in many cases, you will be able to avoid the CT scan. And whenever the child is otherwise well and have just mild kind of injury. So this is a very beautiful diagram which is given in the same paper. This has been adapted from the Lancet 2009, in which they say that concussion versus a brain hemorrhage, that is a brain injury, which happens during the time of accident. If there is a concussion, then the symptoms can be headache, nausea, dizziness, difficult concentrating, but you might get nothing in the CT scan. And the recovery is almost always complete. But these cases are usually admitted for observation and further evaluation for next 24-48 hours. When you think of brain injury, serious injury will happen only in 4 cases and 996 will not have the injury. So when you keep on these predictors, like I have told that these are the predictors, loss of consciousness, mechanism of injury, and not behaving normally as per the parent, and these are the hematoma, the areas. When you go on to these predictors and you think that these are the criteria and the child is otherwise well, you can avoid CT scan. And this is a major chunk. So 4 will have a serious brain injury and other will not have it. One important thing is about the CBC, getting it done in every child. This, though not many much literature is there on anemia and a fainting child, suppose you find out no other etiology and the child has a hemoglobin, has a low hemoglobin, then you should go for further evaluation. They have seen 106 patients with syncope and 71 NMSs, a neural mediated syncope, that is vasovagal syncope, and 35 had other causes. And they have tried to compare these both groups. They have found that there is a high percentage of low iron storage and transferrin saturation and low hemoglobin, though 13.3 is also not low, but even that also, it is clinically significant compared to other group. So they have found that low iron storage and serum ferritin should be tested in those children and should be supplemented to prevent further episodes. This was the table which they have presented. Ferritin was significantly low, transferrin saturation was also significantly low, iron was low and hemoglobin was low. MCB and transferrin binding protein was not significantly related. So what is the mechanism behind this? It leads to abnormal metabolism, catecholamine pathway, epinephrine and norepinephrine. That is why they have this vagal-mediated syncope. So it leads to improper functioning of iron-dependent enzymes and thus the secretion and degradation of catecholamines. Prognosis is excellent in case of vasovagal syncope. The symptoms though recur, we have seen that 30 to 50% will recur, but after the 5 years of onset of symptoms, almost all the patients recover. So we have to explain this to parents that even if they get, it is recurrent, with age it is going to go away. It is not, it is a benign thing and not a serious kind of thing after ruling out the life-threatening etiologies. So the key messages are vasovagal syncope is the most common kind of syncope. We have to try to identify the triggers and the premonitory symptoms. History and examination is of utmost importance because the investigation yield is very low. And advanced investigations are done for the recurrent cases and in expert hands. Lifestyle changes are advised for vasovagal syncope. So thank you. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Rajni, for the informative talk. We have some questions. I'll invite Dr. Manoj Anand Gupta to ask the question live. So I am putting the Dr. Manoj Anand Gupta on live. Dr. Manoj, you can ask your question. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, my question is to rule out postural hypotension, how long the patient should stand, then we should take the blood pressure.
According to American Heart Association, that is a cardiology paper, they have written 10 minutes. 10 minutes of non-exertional standing, you should take a blood pressure and heart rate, and it shows a increase in the heart rate and fall in the BP, then you should go for that criteria.
And the second question is, how we can differentiate between atonic seizure and the syncope?
Okay. Right. See, atonic seizure by definition is loss of tone. So loss of consciousness will not be there. Only there can be just loss of tone in the child. The parents might feel that the child has lost consciousness. The child will fall and suddenly he'll get up. So all the premonitory symptoms, all the autonomic features will not be there. There might be just a fall. So that will give us a clue. And atonic seizures, if it happen in children, it happen multiple times a day. It is not like just happening once.
Thanks, Dr. Rajni. Thanks.
Dr. Rajni, there is another question is that should serum calcium be a part of initial workup? If so, case number 5 could have been diagnosed sooner.
Serum calcium, if we have specific etiologies, like if a child comes with a fainting attack only, then we don't do, except for the CBC. Usually what we do is get a CBC done, get the hemoglobin done. But calcium is specifically done in those cases we suspect epilepsy in a small children. In the adolescent, if you have specific features of hypocalcemia, in our case, the child was never had calcium done. He was thought to be epileptic. He was given anti-epileptic. He came to me on anti-epileptics. MRI was done, EEG was done. So with that specific science and the history that he had this tingling and all, I got the calcium thing done. But yes, it was not done previously. Because the symptoms were common and the child came up with the history. It could have been diagnosed earlier.
Yeah. Okay.
Especially in adolescents, we usually get the history. Without a history, getting such low calcium is actually rare.
Any other question? If you have any question, you please raise your hand and we'll put on, you on live. We will wait for 2 minutes. If anyone has a question, they can always raise the hand.
To my experience, whatever cases I have seen of loss of consciousness or fainting over last 3 years of private practice, I think so. In most of the cases, investigations have not revealed anything. Out of the 10 cases, if I remember, in 3 cases, I could fix up that EEG has abnormality and child has epileptic disorder. But rest of the cases, once or twice they have come and I have told them that keep it as a syncope only. I have not started any anti-epileptic. But yes, follow-up. A constant follow-up and recurrent episode will guide you further. At times, first episode will not be
okay. Dr. Paramjit Singh Kumar has a question. So he'll be asking.
Hello.
Hello, Dr. Rajni. First of all, thank you for such an enlightening talk. I'm Dr. Paramjit, Senior Consultant in Pediatric and Pediatric Senior Consultant in Madhukar Rainbow Hospital with 30 more than three decades of experience. Very good talk, first of all, and really, really enlightening. And would also like to thank IIP North Delhi, who's always very interested in very, very good sessions. Though I am from South Delhi, but I would like to thank Dr. Dinesh Mittal, Dr. Shalini Goel, for their ever, untiring, I really fail to understand, really good talks and really worth for all general pediatricians, PG students. I'm always seeing Dr. Dinesh Mittal, ever smiling face, and Dr. Shalini. I have personally talked to Dr. Shalini also multiple times, and you know, the talks have been really beneficial to all. So it was my first talk, first meeting with you. Just wanted to discuss one case with you. I have one seven-year-old child whom I've been following from the last about 4 years of age. Now he's about seven, 8 years of age. He's a good child, otherwise innocent child, growing well, nothing much. He recently had an episode where he was being taught at home by his father, and he suddenly was not just calculating the normal things which he's supposed to do with his age. He's a totally normally well-developed child, no antenatal history of in the mother, no perinatal history, hypoxia, anything. I mean, and I've been following his child, but that he's very sensitive. If you scold him, he becomes totally stunned for a minute. Huh? Even I have experienced that in my clinic. And I got a call from the parents that the child was, I was teaching the child and he wasn't doing the normal calculations, which he normally does. And he was not very much. So his father scolded and he immediately became stunned and he fell down. And after that, his eyes deviated. And for a short period, he remained in that condition. And then he became slightly dull. And after that, he started becoming all right. When I heard this history and I talked to the father, it was a Sunday, so I took a detailed history on a WhatsApp video conferencing. And after some time, I saw the child was almost normal. There was a history of breath holding spells in the earlier age when he was followed by a pediatric neurologist and was reassured that there's nothing much. But the parents were very worried and said they called somebody, some pediatric neurologist in USA. And I told them that probably it is a non-epileptic episode, most probably related to his psychological events. So then obviously I reassured them and they were wanting an hospitalization. Since the family is an old, I told them there's no need. And probably it would have been one of those convulsive syncope, according to me. So I asked them to get the test done. They haven't got the test. The child is doing well at present, but I still wanted everything to be done as per the protocol. So what is your opinion on this aspect?
So on this aspect, everything looks to be convulsive syncope only. Only the eye deviation thing, which I want to take a more detailed history, that was it very significant?
No, it was only a mild eye deviation and then it just went away. And there was mild, there was minor episode.
Movements were there.
Yes, minor only, which it's recovered.
Syncope also, which because the history prior goes in that way only. But so yes, EEG should be done to rule out any epileptic
movement. Yes, I have ordered all those things. They are, they consulted a pediatric neurologist in USA, their friend. Consult their father, their brother, big brother is a doctor, and they consulted that this is a non-epileptic episode. So please don't go to any investigation. Though I told them to get an EEG done also, but they haven't. So I mean, what do you think is the approach? Is my approach correct that probably this child would probably not be having a seizure or an epileptic episode? It will probably be a non-epileptic episode because of one reason, just that there was eye deviation and a little chronic movement. I thought that it's better and be safe to get an EEG done. And if required, probably go ahead with the other investigations also. I did write, but they did not get it done. And the child is well, but they do have a history of emotional lability, all those episodes. So considering the fact, even if he doesn't get the investigations, do you think that we are in a safe zone?
Yeah, we are in a safe zone. See, since episodes are not getting recurred, if it is has to be epileptic, it might recur again and again.
So basically,
one this episode and no prior episode, even if getting no investigations is okay, because we have,
right.
Yeah, it's a very vague kind of clue that having a mild eye deviation or some clonic movements. So not a too typical seizure-like event. We did not get any investigations done. That also is fine.
So this will be probably labeled as a convulsive syncope.
Yeah, it can be labeled as
that. Yeah, thank you. So because I actually also thought of that, right? And thank you for your guiding. I appreciate the whole IAP North India team again, Dr. Dinesh and Dr. Shalini, once again, for such a wonderful series of, please include, you should put it on Delhi IAP, all the webinars, so that the other zones can also equally participate in that. Thank you so much.
We have a YouTube channel also, and all the webinars are also recorded out there, and they are also telecasted live on the YouTube. And right now also, almost around 25-30 people are watching on the YouTube live.
Dr. Dinesh, can you make it in the this thing, the YouTube, your link, so that everybody can see the earlier?
In the invite link also, it was there. It is the IAP North Delhi TV. You just search IAP North Delhi TV and subscribe to our channel. Almost each and every webinar will be there.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rajni. It was nice to interact with you. And thanks, Dr. Dinesh.
Thank you for the good words.
And thank you, Dr. Shalini. I talked to you once and you were very compliant on the phone also. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Param, sir. And now we have a senior member, Dr. Prashant Seth. He wants to ask some questions.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Dr. Prashant, you ask. Sorry.
Am I
Dr. Prashant? Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
So I was just complimenting Dr. Rajni. I have always had the pleasure of listening to her. We had few meetings in West Delhi as well, and everyone enjoyed really. So coming to this question and this topic, so what I gathered from most of your things. Like in doubtful cases, EEG can also be a very contributory finding in diagnosis of whether it was a syncopal event or whether it could be a seizure event. What do you say, Dr. Rajni? So along with, of course, good clinical history.
Yeah. So when the history and examination is doubtful, that you're not able to fix whether it is an epileptic event or a syncopal event or a psychogenic event, you should get an EEG done. Like overdoing an investigation which is non-invasive is okay on a clinical perspective. But I would just like to say that when you do a EEG, please advise a sleep-deprived EEG. Whenever we do that way, we increases the yield of getting an EEG done. Getting a very short 20-minute EEG might not be informative. When we do a prolonged EEG and we do it sleep-deprived, this might lead to, many of times I have seen in my experience also, it increases the yield to about 20 to 25%, which is a huge number.
I saw that sleep-derived EEG in your presentation. And in fact, I wanted to draw the notice of all the audience towards it. So before getting CT or MRI, I wanted to make this point only, that among the take-home messages, that after the good clinical history, before getting CT or MRI done, EEG would be a better investigation.
Yes, true, very true.
And second thing about Dr. Narang's case, just now what he was discussing, why couldn't we consider malingering in that? I think that is also very possible, looking at the whole clinical scenario. Malingering of seizures, like psychogenic causing.
Child was, I think, 4 years old. Child was very young.
4 years old can malinger. I have seen.
He was 8 years.
Yeah, that
when he was seen. But there was prior history that whenever this kind of it was a reflex syncope, basically. That situational syncope. He always becomes stunned whenever he sees a doctor. Like even with Dr. Param, when he used to visit in OPD and he had this unusual situation, he used to just get stunned. So with these situations, if there are recurrent episodes, then I think malingering goes out and this reflex syncope comes forward.
Right. But it can be considered because sometimes some children want to avoid that situation.
And for the secondary gains, yes, of course.
For the secondary gains, right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Prashant. Now, Dr. Mohan Kundal want to ask the question. Dr. Mohan, please unmute yourself. Dr. Mohan, you are there?
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, sir.
I just wanted to know about a case scenario. I remember yesterday, one of the child who's 2 years old, male child who was admitted yesterday with the transient seizure last approximately 30 seconds. Was very much normal. He's and no neurological deficit. Although when we did his EEG, it was showing generalized epileptic form discharge. So I just wanted to know whether he qualifies for any anti-epileptic or not.
So you mean to say first episode of clear seizure event, which is very brief, 30 seconds, with EEG abnormal?
Right? Yes.
In a developmentally normal child?
Yes, very well.
So, taking up the case, first thing is the clinical scenario. Are we sure that this is a seizure and not a seizure mimic or a movement disorder? If suppose the pathology is clear that this is epileptic, then fine. We take this as a clinical history and this could be epilepsy. The briefness or the duration does not decide it. The semiology decides it. The second thing is EEG. Are we sure that the EEG, whatever has been reported, is abnormal? Because at times it happens that the small children, we do a sleep EEG, they are sleep markers, which absolutely looks like a abnormal generalized epileptic form discharges. So EEG reporting and the clinical history makes the diagnosis.
Okay. I believe that going by the history by the mother, it was more like a seizure. And at the same time, there is a family history of a seizure in the uncle and he is already on anti-epileptic.
Okay. So this could be a case that the child has first event of seizure. And if we are sure on the clinical semiology, because clinical thing can only define that this is a seizure episode. So it is first episode, seizure unprovoked with abnormal EEG, you would start an antiepileptic. If you are sure on clinical things with abnormal EEG.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Mohan. Now, I think it should be the last case. We are approaching 6. So here we have a very senior member, Dr. Dharmendra Diwan. Dr. Diwan, sir, please unmute your mic.
Okay. Good evening, Dr. Rajni. You have given a very nice, detailed, presentation and full of knowledge. My question is regarding this vasovagal or syncopal attack, whether the presentation differs in adults and children. I mean, is it similar in both the cases or there is any element of differentiation in terms of presentation, clinical presentation, number one. And second, I wanted to make an observation or a comment regarding the case that was discussed by one of the senior doctors in South Delhi. Because this child, where he was following this child for 4 years, because probably the father was, teaching the child while it happened, there could be, and this may be the only child of the parents, overprotected, that type of emotional this thing, therefore maybe an attention seeking sort of episode presenting in this, the one that somebody else also mentioned, whether it could be malingering or this thing. So that is an observation, but the question remains regarding the vasovagal presentation of adult versus children. Is there any difference?
Okay, so thank you for your kind words. And coming to the question, difference between the adult and the children. The triggers and the premonitory symptoms of syncope are usually normal. I mean, both the cases have same the thing. But these presentations are more common. The vasovagal syncope, usually in children it is 60 to 80%, but it is even more common in adults. So that is one thing. And in terms of differentiation, if we come, then not typically aware of, actually. I think it's more or less same.
Okay.
And coming to the case, which you told that it could be a attention-seeking behavior. It yeah. might be attention-seeking behavior. We have to look at other instances. Not only one instance will lead to the same. Suppose the child behaves during the non-event time also. He has this attention-seeking behavior, then this might be considered that he wants to avoid the teaching or he wants to avoid that annoying behavior.
So that means this pediatrician needs to, you know, further assess from the parents, taking a history regarding similar episodes of attention seeking from this particular child needs to be, you know, interrogated by the pediatrician from the parents to actually come at the root of this issue. That is what you are suggesting in this particular case.
Yeah. A psychological evaluation can be taken so that they know that it is just a reflex syncope. Basically, the child should lose consciousness during that time, not just getting dizzy or lying down or that kind of behavior. If true loss of consciousness is happening during that time, then we can take as a vasovagal syncope only. That is a reflex phenomena. Mm-hmm. If it is not there, then psychological evaluation should be taken that why is the child so emotionally labile or why these episodes bother him?
And in terms of intelligence quotient, IQ, in such children should be very, very high. Such children are expected to be possessing a very high IQ because of which attention seeking may be more.
And they usually perform good in studies. So study criteria is not the thing because they have high IQ.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Rajni, if you allow, can I take one or two more questions, although we are all shooting the time?
Sure, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rajni. Now, Dr. Bajaj also want to ask a question. I'm putting Dr. Bajaj online. Sir, Dr. Bajaj, sir, please unmute yourself and ask.
Thank you, Dr. Rajni. I think I had been listening to you. It's a nice talk. One of a child around 6-7 years suddenly woke up from a deep sleep and went to the restroom and fall down, got injured also. So is it a syncope or we should investigate further? No past history, no other complaints.
So was it a witnessed event when he went to washroom? Did somebody?
Yeah, he fell down. He fell down and got injured also. Mm-hmm. After that, the child was conscious when the mother came to that see the child. Mm-hmm. The child was put to bed and he slept again.
Okay. And no further episode. This is only one episode.
This is only one episode.
It could be taken as syncope only because it was a very quick response which happened. And the timing is also like going to washroom, micturating. That event is considered as a common timing to have these kind of episodes.
And can it happen in adults also? Because often I have heard about a person who was a young person, suddenly woke up, went to the restroom, collapsed and expired. So was it a cardiac syncope?
Collapsed and expired.
Yeah, that's right. So is it some sort of a cardiac syncope or it was an MI or something like that? Because after that, it was not investigated further.
Most likely it was a cardiac event only, sir, because sudden death with only happened during that time. The other differential could be transient ischemic attack. Usually what we see in an ischemic attack in adults, when they get stroke, they get up nicely, or whenever they get up, they go to washroom and they will have an event. So that's a stroke-like event. But that will be a gradual process and no sudden death is noted. So sudden death leads to some cardiac event only, which probably was missed in that child.
And once recently, one of my relatives, he's 35 years old, lieutenant colonel in the army. He had probably 2 or 3 drinking session at night, slept comfortably, suddenly woke up. And again, he had a giddiness, fell down. Then he was investigated. Probably there was a little bit of sinus arrhythmia. Then MRI was normal. He was kept on Holter monitor. Everything came out to be the normal. But there is a definite history of death in the family because of cardiac events. So he was a little worried. So what it could be? It was a one-time event, again, some sort of suddenly drinking session and got giddiness or something. Mm-hmm. He should be very careful about further. Because he was kept for around a week in the army hospital. Neurologist also saw, then cardiac person, Holter monitor. Sinus arrhythmia was there. That was the only thing. Mm-hmm. So should he be very careful and further investigate, or we should leave it on there because everything has been done?
If the patient has been clearly investigated clearly by the cardiologist and neurologist and no organic lesion has been found, and this is the only one event which has happened,
right,
he need not be worried. Though we know that as a family history, it is there in the back of the mind. If the event recurs, if even a single event will recur, then they should go further. Like they are further things of monitoring. They can get an intracardiac loop catheter. They can have cardiac catheterization because of the family history being very high and getting a recurrent episode. So I think that is the key. And intermittent ECG can be done. Like every 2 monthly or 3 monthly, if they feel any giddiness or some kind of episode, that baseline ECG can be repeated again. The non-specific changes were there. So they can get that ECG repeat again, because that's a non-invasive thing and that might lead to sometimes a problem.
Another question. I had a child who was around 6-7 years.
Mm-hmm.
He used to wake up suddenly, used to cry a lot, make a very frightening sound for 5 to 10 minutes. Okay. After that, he became normal. He never lost consciousness. This episode continued to happen twice a year, 3 times a year, 4 times a year. He was investigated. CT scan, MRI was normal, but the child was not improving. So just telling you, because then I suspected some sort of epileptic only attack, because he made a video. I don't have a video with me. I put him on carbamazepine. This is a quite 4-5 years back event.
Mm-hmm.
And for the next 2 years, the child has been controlled. So should I continue this carbamazepine, or should I investigate, or what should be done?
So only if there is a crying episode, which is there in sleep.
It's not crying. He used to make a sound like as if something is happening. Very frightening sound. And 4-5 years of age. He used to cry like...
common in that age group. So we cannot rule out any sleep disorder versus epilepsy. For that thing, we can do a prolonged EEG. That is one thing, that overnight EEG can be done. The other thing is, getting a polysomnography. If both the events, both the investigations are normal, and since the child has responded beautifully to the drug, we can do one thing, we can taper up the drug, do a repeat EEG and provoke the seizure. I mean, provoke the event. If that event is epileptic, then it might recur again and we can capture in video EEG.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bajaj sir. We will take the last question of this session. It will be by Dr. Bharat Bhushan. Dr. Bharat, please unmute your mic. Dr. Bharat, you are there?
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Yeah, please ask.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, sir. Yeah, yeah.
Ma'am, my wife, friend's daughter is selected in engineering college. Is having complaint, 18-year-old, having complaint of sudden blackout many times in the last 2 or 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe what is the reason she asked me, and how do we approach?
Okay, so it is only the blackout episode, no loss of consciousness, no loss of tone.
No loss of consciousness.
Is there any history of headache?
No headache.
Only loss of consciousness does not lead to any specific diagnosis, because there should be some only blackouts. Is there any specific timing? I think we should take a detailed history, a more detailed history, and an ocular examination. Of the evaluation. Is it blackout or it is just a like a foreign body coming in front of the eyes, like a black kind of thing? The child can tell us in detail. Only blackouts does not lead to any neurological diagnosis. There should be something else which we might miss in history. Only the child can tell us.
The cervical spondylitis we can think of?
No, cervical spondylitis cannot lead to the sudden blackouts, which can happen multiple times. Only the symptoms. If cervical has to cause this, there has to be other symptoms as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bharat. We have a lot of other questions also, but due to the time constraint, it is not possible to take each and every question here. We'll be sharing the number of Dr. Rajni in our WhatsApp group, and you can ask her personally also. Dr. Rajni is a pediatric neurologist in B.L. Kapoor Hospital, and you can contact her there also. So with this, we will be ending this session. And we will be inviting you for our next session. And as you all know that the breastfeeding week is going on. So we have kept a session on the breastfeeding by none other than the president of Breastfeeding Promotion Network of India, Dr. Arun Gupta, will be meeting on Saturday 5 p.m. Dr. Shalini, you want to say something?
I want to say that we are coming with few more interesting topics in our coming Wednesday digital series, and I hope you will be there. You all will be there for with us for the next meeting. Thank you, Dr. Rajni. It was a very nice and informative talk, and I think my all doubts, most of the doubts are cleared now. And thank you very much for being with us. Thank you, Dr. Rajni.
Thank you for the opportunity which you have given us, and kudos to the team. I mean, you all are doing great. What I have seen, the work you both have done in past so many months have not been done in so many years. People have done it, they do it, and it's a very enthusiastic group. It's a lovely group, not Delhi. The whole team is good. I mean, your presentation is fantastic, but the whole group is so enthusiastic, and they are, I just cannot say. It's a specific kind of group which is there in part of group of the Delhi, which is very enthusiastic.
Thank you for your kind words, Dr. Rajni.
And speak to you all.
We are really blessed to have you with us.
I'm always there, ma'am, anytime.
Thank you so much.
I want to can I also subscribe to this channel so that I can see further videos?
Yeah,
absolutely. 100%. Ma'am. It is IAP North Delhi TV. Just type IAP North Delhi TV and you can always subscribe to our channel.
And you can also tell your residents to join this channel, to subscribe
anyone,
this channel.
Anyone can join. Join us. Okay.
Thank you, and bye-bye, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Okay.